April 2015, the last week of April, my daughter, who was in her eighth grade and was giving her exams, she had fever for 7 days. We investigated her, and all the investigations came normal, and she continued giving the exams. On day 10, my daughter had some neck stiffness, and she said that she sounded confused. So if you have fever, neck stiffness, a bit of confusion, the diagnosis in any doctor's mind is meningitis. That's what she had. So we rushed her to the hospital, admitted her, and started treatment for meningitis as quickly as possible. So just for the sake of the audience, I would like to explain two aspects of brain. Our brain is made up of two matters, gray matter and white matter. The nerve cell, the thinking nerve cell, is your gray matter, and all the connections, the cables, which come out of those nerve cells and communicate with each other is your white matter. Those are the axons. So you have gray matter, the computer, which is thinking for you, and you have the cables or the connections which keep sending signals to the rest of the body. Now, these connections connect you from one part of the brain to the other part, one hemisphere of the brain to the other hemisphere, and some of these fibers go down and connect to the spinal cord and the rest of the body. So if you look at this picture, whatever I've drawn gray on that is gray matter, and everything else is white matter. Even that pink thing is white matter. Now, the pink track there is the one which is going down, and it goes through a very, very narrow area inside the brain. It is inside the brain. There's a narrow area called, it's like a door, an internal capsule. All these fibers from the brain go through that internal capsule. And what my daughter had was an infarct, an area of non-functioning area because of loss of blood supply, an infarct in that area. So it was a white stroke. It's called a capsular stroke. It was in the connecting fibers, not in the nerve cells, but in the connecting fibers, and she became paraplegic. So this led to 3 weeks of semi-coma. It was all still and silent. She did not speak a word for 3 weeks. She did not move. What do you do? What do you do when you want to do so many things, but your daughter is not moving? So I just a background, as Neeta said, that we both are oncosurgeons. We took our MRI to almost every neurologist and neurosurgeon in the country, and we were staying abroad for a long time, so we sent all the mails to every possible country in this world to just get an opinion that what is the extent of damage, will she ever recover from this particular stroke? The answer was, All the surgeons and the neurologists were polite. They said, she's young. The young brain is plastic. There's plasticity of the brain. Plasticity is the ability to rewire, the ability to rewire. So we can learn. That's why youngsters can learn things quickly, because they have the ability to rewire. It's that she has got plasticity, but only time will tell us whether she's going to recover completely. So nobody had an answer. And I'm in medicine, and I know the limitations of medicine. We know few things. We don't know everything. Okay. So I asked my sister, who happens to be a gynecologist, find something in literature which will give me an idea, experimental journey on trying to do something to my daughter. Stimulating the senses. Now, we all know, how do you stimulate your brain? Through 5 senses. But here I have a situation where the patient or my daughter is lying like a paraplegic. She has no sensation. She can't move her skin. I cannot stimulate her skin. She's not talking. She's not eating. She's not seeing. She's completely closed red. Which special sense? She has got, I do not know whether she could hear, whether she could smell. These were the only 2 senses. I thought they might be okay. So it's very difficult to stimulate somebody in an intensive care unit when they have a stroke, because you do not know how to stimulate them. So what I started doing was, got lots of oils, different oils, perfumes, aromatic oils. They said, get this. I started massaging her. I just thought that oil is therapeutic, actually. So oil massage, and I thought a maternal touch, a mother's touch, probably will wake her up at some point. But nothing happened. I kept on religiously doing this, but nothing happened. It was, maybe something was happening, but it was not evident on the outside. Maybe I was sending some signals, but I didn't know whether I was sending, or it was just a futile exercise and I was just massaging. The passive physiotherapy continued in the hospital. The doctors were very kind. The neurologists, the intensivists really, really looked after her meningitis part, but we were left with paraplegia. After 1 week of this silence, which I couldn't bear, I thought, let us stimulate these muscles. These muscles have gone dead. There's no signal to the muscle. So I thought, let us get some electrical stimulus. Pain is one of the most important stimulus to the brain. So I said, let's stimulate the muscles with some sort of electrodes or tense machine. So I geared up for that and started stimulating these large muscles on the thigh and large muscles on the back of the leg. And after a week or so, I started getting some twitch, a little tiny twitch. You had to look carefully to see that twitch. And I knew I was going in the right direction. We kept stimulating, and a little more twitches started coming. But again, that was experimental, nothing, this thing. But I was trying to send some senses to my daughter. Then second week, my daughter has not spoken. I'm very frustrated. It's nearly 2 weeks I've not heard her voice. I'm very emotionally disturbed. One night, I was going back to the hospital just to connect with her. And I went to the intensive care. That usually, night duties were done by my husband. Day duties I did, and we shared among our relatives, my in-laws, my sister, everybody sort of gave us a break. I went there, sat in front of her. I was in a cubicle. I could sort of sing or do whatever I wanted inside the intensive care. And I started singing a song just for my sake, nothing to do with the experiments which I was trying to do. I said, let me start singing. I sang this song, which I always sang to my kids at bedtime. It's in my own language, which they don't understand, my mother tongue, but they used to love that song. I started singing this song, closing my eyes for my sake. And after 5 minutes, I saw my daughter. There was a labored breathing. She was breathing heavily. The girl who has never moved in her in the last 2 weeks, almost given up, and started having some sort of a twitch. I essentially thought, is a meningitis coming back, or she getting a fit or something? I didn't know. I just observed her, and I realized that there was some sort of a contortion in her face, a little tiny contortion, and some amount of twitching which was going on. I stopped the song, and after 2 minutes, that stopped. Again, I continued the song. It was very tiny. It was very tiny. And being in medical field, I could observe those little differences which I was seeing on her face and her body. So I continued. After that, I kept on singing all sorts of songs with all sorts of languages just to see in case. Some days it worked, some days it didn't work. So I didn't know whether I was breaking into that little barrier of her brain. Second, the break came when my son rang up on the phone, which was on a speaker phone in the intensive care, and he just asked me in an afternoon, Mama, when are you coming home? I'm getting bored. So I said, I started talking, and he was talking. 2 minutes down the line, I see my daughter. Her right side was completely, but her left side was started slightly. There was some activity in the left side. She started moving towards the left side, and the voice was coming from my phone on that side. So I just saw this quickly. I said, keep talking, I said. She's trying to connect. She heard the voice. So she started moving very, very lightly. It was not even a major movement, very tiny movements, but I could make out that this voice is connected to her subconscious or whatever type of consciousness we have at that point of semi-coma. One of the physicians, so I knew something has helped her. One of the physicians who was a visiting physician said, do you want to try Tibetan bell therapy? I said, I don't mind trying anything. Give me anything, I'll try, as long as it's not harmful to my daughter. So she gave me all these Tibetan bells, and I was holding this in the intensive care unit, doing dung, dung like a priest. And I could feel, like the more I did it, that she started coming. The eye contact was much longer. So I kept doing it as if it was sound therapy, basically, at the end of the day, and it helped. So somewhere, the auditory senses were somewhere and aligning her brain. I couldn't find prove the hypothesis right, but I could see that observation, by my observation, that something was helping her. Now we started, as I said, we had to move immediately to the, once she was stabilized, I said, let's go. She had a nasogastric tube, she was being fed through the tube. I said, let's take her in an ambulance. I went and reached this hospital, which has got a large rehab center, and I said, I want 6 sessions of physiotherapy for my daughter. They said, she's weak, she can't have 6 sessions, she's really going to be, I said, no. Let's start it. Let's bombard the brain with as much as possible. If she can't tolerate it, let's then go back rather than the other way around. So 6 sessions of physiotherapy we bombarded for nearly 4 or 5 months, and out of that, 2 sessions were robotic physiotherapy. When I went there for that particular reason, and they said it might be useful. It's no proof, but you can try. You can try 20 to 40 sessions, and I saw my daughter standing on that robot. the girl who has never moved in her life for the last 6 weeks is strapped to the robo and she starts walking. She starts walking because the robo is making her walk. She's not walking. But just to see your daughter walk like that itself was a healing thing for me. And you can imagine the person's brain who has undergone stroke, there is a mirror in front of that robo and they're walking. The thought that you are capable of doing something itself is a stimulus to do something. So I felt this is going to work. I had the hand physiotherapy and this, instead of 40 sessions, I took 200 sessions. I said, just do it, she's going to walk, she's going to stand straight, her muscles are going to be okay. I said, no, you're not going to lose anything by just walking for 45 minutes. So this, and the physiotherapists were excellent, they all just kept on, she was a young girl, they kept on doing a lot of things on her. Sorry, this is backwards. Then when there were lots of perks of being in Mumbai. If you're in Mumbai, if you don't make use of the Bollywood land, what's the point? What's the point? So in that particular hospital, lots of celebrities used to come. I had to put this picture because it has a meaning to some sort of a social, emotional improvement to a patient, and it's very important. And she was quite friend. My daughter was quite friendly to all the old stroke and young stroke victims in the thing. And it was like everybody was walking like this or walking like this, and everybody, one was depressed, one was not depressed, but it was their group. It was all stroke patients. They were all together. And I still remember when she used to walk in the thing, uncle, aapka right hand chalta na ye? Mera right hand chalta. Give me a high five with the other hand. So these were some of the things which she was cheering up some of the older ones. The ones with gray stroke sometimes have got little depression. So they're little close. But my daughter was somehow never depressed all throughout this particular episode. I was standing next to the lift and suddenly Anushka Sharma, I said, oh, Anushka, I've never taken a photo with a celebrity. I've been very shy, asking anybody anything. So she's, mama, mama, Anushka. I said, I know, what am I supposed to, mama, mama, mama. Then suddenly I saw this eyes that she wanted something for out of her. I didn't know how to ask. I stood for a minute. The lift was not, I hadn't come, luckily. And I gathered my courage and said, do you mind taking a photo with my daughter? She took a photograph. She said, of course not. She took a photograph. And then that day, my daughter became a celebrity in her circles, basically. I met Anushka. And I could see the excitement. This girl who is going back and forth, I could see this excitement. Same happened with Shatrughna Sinha. He just walked past and she didn't know who he was. I said, he's Sonakshi's father. She said, oh, really? Oh, let's have a photograph. And he said, you're Sonakshi's father? Then actually I could see the pride in his, father's pride in his eyes. Yes, come on, and he took a photograph. And even Bharti, we met her in a coffee shop downstairs, and she came and gave a big hug and spoke. All these people actually, after this, she kept on showing these photos for 3-4 months. That made her a part of a society which she was living in, and also a smart part of the, and a really smart part of the society which people want to do with. So that gave her something to look forward to, some little story here and little story there. There was a child in the rehabilitation center. He had come from abroad for rehab, and he was crying. My daughter walks up and said, you don't cry? Give me a high five. We are coma buddies. She said, we are coma buddies. I've never heard that. I'd never heard such an association. Coma buddies don't cry, she said. Can you be like coma buddies? So I think even Oxford Dictionary can get that particular thing. So she was fairly good enough. We rehabilitated her for 7-8 months, and we thought we'll send her back to school. She was excited to go. She was really excited to go. She went the first day, and the school introduced her to the assembly as a brave soldier. And she rang me up in the hospital I was working, and she said, mama, mama, they called me a brave soldier. I've become a celebrity there as well. All the kids, the little kids are looking at me in the toilet. Meghna Didi, Meghna Didi. I said, okay, fine. And then I came back home. She said, I know they said that I'm a great fighter, but what did I fight, she said. She didn't understand what she had fought. She thought, I'm a soldier, they said. I liked it because I was standing on the street. She didn't know. And the same next week, she was watching a movie with the three idiots with her brother. And you know there's a scene, if you have seen 3D, there's a coma scene inside that, semi-coma scene, and people are all dancing. And he said, Prithvi, that person in coma is just sleeping. He's not sad. She said, that boy, he's not sad. The people around you him are sad. I was quite relieved that her experience of that intensive care was just a sleep, which I think. So I was quite relieved as a mother that she did not get into that type of a negative psychology inside the intensive, or subconsciously something has upset her. She was quite happy in school for a few months. And I thought, oh, she can walk. She went with the thing. She could walk a little with a limp, but I thought things are over. Things are getting better. And she was quite a happy child. She used to talk to everybody. But 2 months down the line, I started seeing the mood swings, the tantrums. She was not adjusting. She was not adjusting at all to school. Something about it. She had lost an ear, and her friends had gone ahead, and she had to go with the junior class. And she was neither there nor here. And with all those gadgets and all those shoes, which was worn, I don't think you can make any new friends with that type of a picture. So she couldn't make new friends, she couldn't adjust, and the class pace of teaching was so fast for her, she couldn't synthesize so much of information. And she used to come back and say this word, "Mama, when people are teaching too much for too long, I feel I've got a traffic jam in my head." 4 years back, I thought we had a catastrophic event in our life. Catastrophic is the word. And imagine two doctors and your child suddenly goes off paraplegic. People say, "Well, you didn't recognize it. You didn't recognize." So many people kept on asking. And it's not in a good way, but I had no control over the situation. But 4 years from now, I think it's a milestone. This particular event which happened in our lives is a milestone. We have learned so many things, and I never knew. My kids were quite smart and intelligent. I never knew in a school when a child lags behind, what is the trauma to the parent. The child is lagging behind. You have no control. The child doesn't have a friend. You have no control. What do you do? I never was in that situation in my life. And for some reason, God gave me that opportunity. Oh, there is a pace. She always said, "Teachers teach people who are smart, Mama. I'm not smart now, so I'm lagging behind." I said, "It's okay. Go slowly. You'll reach somewhere." So finally, this was Holi, just before Holi in 2015, we had played Holi very well and she fell ill and I couldn't do Holi after that. We used to go off to a hotel during holidays so that she'll not have the trauma of not playing Holi. This year, Holi, we were all together, she jumped, she threw colors at everybody, and this gray matter and white matter and all those matters disappeared. It was all full of colors and I was really, really happy with what happened. So the reason I wanted to say this narrative, it's just a narrative, is there are lots of people out there with strokes, lots of relatives out there, just keep trying everything. And in medicine, what happens is we know a few things, we tell that to patients, but there are so many things which we don't say, unless they try, and I was quite strong enough, we were quite strong enough to experiment with a lot of things. Just try, I can write a whole book of the experiments I've done with my daughter. But what I'm trying to say is try, never hang up on your boots and you'll get there. And today is auspicious day, it's Easter and it's a new life day. And I felt that my daughter has had a new life after meningitis and we have no regrets of what happened. We'll move on. And I want everybody who has had something similar in their lifetime to just move on and keep going. Thank you very much for listening.